Yeah, they've killed two Nkuhuma lionesses, one in February. The male leopard is still on the road here. One in February, one last month, and then now a Styx lioness last night. It really is bizarre. So, two coalitions ago, there was a group called the Mapocho. And the Mapocho were a group of six, initially, male lions. And they killed countless females, which was really abhorrent behavior. We don't know why they did that. So Jimmelin in Oklahoma, Brian, should we just quickly have a look at the hyena den? Let's just quickly have a look here. Jimmelin in Oklahoma, you say if they're intent on killing all of these females, who they're going to mate with? I don't think it's a question of being intent on killing all of these females. I think it's an instinctual reaction to taking a territory over. They are hyped up, their blood is up, their testosterone is coursing, they're inexperienced, and so anything that gets in their way that doesn't show complete submission is going to find itself dead in fairly short order. So it's not a conscious intention. Of course, it's extremely difficult for us to know where conscious intention is replaced by complete instinct. I don't see any action here. Now we did check that buffalo carcass, so there we go, we've got some hyenas there. Marvelous. Good news. I will continue with my brief story once we've gotten to a position where you can see them. Hello, fellows. Is that alright, Brian? There we have two hyenas, everybody. Two youngsters. That, if I'm not horribly mistaken, I keep forgetting the dates when of the births of everybody, but I think these hyenas were born in February. I think that's when they were born. There were three generations at the last den, and I think that the oldest one, there was an old one on its own. Then there were these two little ones, and then of course the tiny little one, which I'm sure is in the hole just behind these ones and will only come out when its mother's here, when there's an adult around. But I think the biggest one is now probably foraging with the clan, as opposed to spending too much time here at the den. A lovely picture of them sitting in the morning sun. Anyway, we were talking about the Birmingham boys and their propensity to kill, and they took out a buffalo two nights ago. The Franklins are disturbing my thought process. There we go. They're mercifully quiet for now. That's the crested Franklin. Anyway, the Birmingham boys killed a buffalo. They fed on it for a day, and then at night they moved off. Well, there was still lots of meat left. They headed off and they roared and roared and roared all the way down south. They went down south into beyond our boundaries, into Chitwa Chitwa and in Koro, and that is where they found the Styx lionesses, and they obviously killed one of them. I'd love to know the circumstances around how that happened or why. And we went to the buffalo carcass today. We didn't find anything there, but it's definitely been fed on during the night. And we did hear some hyenas shouting at night, and so I'm pretty sure that the hyenas had a good go at it last night. And we did wonder why they took so long to go there, and I couldn't explain it. And then Brent and Scott came up with, I think, it's quite a viable situation. The hyenas will be well aware that when those five male lions were roaring, that if there's one thing a hyena is afraid of, it's a male lion. They'd have been well aware that there were five male lions around. And because they are short, look at that one, you can see him standing up, he's picked something up on the wind. But because they're short, they, of course, do not see over the vegetation the same way we do. So if they think that there are five male lions around, they're going to be very reticent to, oh look, those are two different ages. See that, Brian? So that is the biggest cub there. And then, so we have got all three generations here, assuming that the small black cub is in that hole. It's interesting. So they would have been reticent to go and approach a lion kill if they thought that the male lions were around. And now they're obviously aware that it isn't, so that they aren't, so that they went off and they've definitely fed on that carcass last night. Having a very easy morning, these fellows. Enjoying the sounds of the woodland kingfisher going, bitty for you, bitty for you, in the background. And also, of course, the crested barbet. Endlessly noisy crested Franklin. They really are some of the most magnificent animals, these hyena. So we don't always see these youngsters around the den here. The older one certainly, I think, is doing some foraging with the clan. The younger one probably not yet, but what's interesting is that younger one has a sibling, or had a sibling, and I'm just wondering why it isn't here. And I wonder when it was last seen, A, because I haven't seen it for a while, and B, Brian, have you seen it at this den?
The little one.
No, the other middle-sized one. Mm-hmm. I wonder if it hasn't met a sticky end somehow. So, the littler one of these two will probably spend most of its time here at the den. Definitely still go into a hole if it feels threatened. But the bigger one will start to move with the clan now and forage. Probably almost big enough to be going on its own. Very tired. They are ostensibly nocturnal, so you'll find that they would probably have just come back to the den, especially that little one, from a night of foraging around the place. I don't think we're going to spend too long here. I think maybe we should just get back onto those leopard tracks. They walk straight past this den, and of course a male leopard will be a little bit of a danger to hyena, but the hyena den inside that hole, quite interestingly, is designed such that nothing bigger than the actual resident of the hole can get into it. And what happens is that once the cub is born, it goes into the chosen hole and instinctively digs out a shelf on which it can sit, into which nothing bigger than it can get. So a male leopard wouldn't be able to go down into that hole and fetch out the hyena cub, well, not without huge difficulty anyway. And they definitely do present, male leopards definitely present a hazard to both wild dog pups and hyena cubs who live around these termite mounds. So if he has come past here, they will be very aware of it. They certainly don't look particularly terrified by life, though, here on this almost completely perfect African dawn. So I think we're going to leave the hyenas here for now. Let's press on, see if we can't pick up more tracks of that male leopard. It would be wonderful to see a male leopard today, especially in this golden dawn light. Here we go. Goodbye, hyenas. Have a marvelous day. Now, they really did do a job by getting in here. It's not hard to walk into this area, but because it's the dry season, and it's been a very dry season, the elephants have been in here and basically hammered to pieces this particular part of the bush. And so there are broken trees all over the place, which make it fairly hazardous for a car to try and get in and out of. Fear not, Wendy, brave soul that she is, will get us in and out. Of course, we don't want to make too much in the way of roads, so we'll try and use the same track in and out. You've been watching for a while, the termite mound that we had, the last den that we had, that the hyenas used to use, was a little bit, smaller than the one that this one is on, and so that just all that means is that this termite mound is a bit older than the other one. I don't know how old they are, and it's very difficult to gauge, especially, you know, termite mounds can be decolonized and then recolonized, and so it's difficult to tell exactly. This male leopard is still on the road here. It's difficult to tell exactly how old they are. It's lion track now. Lion tracks here too. Only one set. And down the road here, one lioness. Where she went from here though. I'm just going to quickly get hold of Scott on the radio. He is hailing me. Go ahead. No, negative. Copy that, I'll head there now. So Scott has just got hold of me and said he can hear some crazy hyena activity. He's going to go and have a quick look, and then we'll head down there. He says they're shouting wildly in one of the drainage lines close by. We've still got leopard tracks on the road here. And Angie in Ohio, while we're driving along into this rather exciting morning, that is beautiful. Okay, we're going to move a little bit quicker now and see if we can't catch up with those hyenas that Scott is talking about. But Angie, you want to know, are hyenas nervous or scared of lions and leopards? And would they run away? Absolutely they would. They would run away from lions, certainly. From leopards, not so much. Remember, a leopard is not going to pose a huge physical challenge to a hyena, not because they are not stronger than a hyena, because they are one-on-one, probably one-for-one, they are probably are stronger. But because they cannot afford to take the risk to get injured. A leopard is a solitary animal, can't afford to get injured, If it does get injured, it won't hunt again, and so it won't eat. So while a hyena would be quite nervous of a leopard, they do know that a leopard is unlikely to push forward a physical attack when they're evenly matched. A lion is a totally different story. A lion will absolutely push home a physical attack, because much like the hyena, they also live in a group. So they can afford to take more risks, because they can still eat if other members of the pride are killing. And I'm going to move quite quickly now. So hold on tight. What have we got there, Brian?
Little tracks. Leopard.
We've got male leopard tracks here. Something to do with why the hyenas are making such a big noise, just south, apparently just to the south of the Gari Dam. The leopard is now on the road here. You can see him. You can see him when we came sort of past here today, very early morning. Keep you posted on where we are. We're on basically near where we have the fireside chat on quarantine clearings, which is now to our right hand side. Keep an eye out for leopards and lions as we drive. Not sure what those hyenas would be shouting at. Let's go and have a look. Gonna get hold of Scott again quickly. Scott, come in. Scott, do copy. Scott, best approach to go down from that. Leopard is moving down this road now. Okay, copy that. This is amazing. Okay, so we're coming up to the Gari Dam now, and the hyena were shouting initially there, and apparently they've headed south. They have stopped calling. We don't know what they were shouting at or why. Male leopard is on the same road, and it's on top of our vehicle tracks from this morning. He goes, I think he goes off across there, you know. I'm just going to switch off and listen. Keep an eye on the Gari Dam cam, everybody, just to see if perhaps something doesn't pop up here. Can't hear anything. I'm going to carry on south. The male leopard track heads exactly in there, and maybe that's what the hyenas found. They're having a fight. Gonna head straight south from here and see what happens. No. Stop and listen all the time, just to see. Try and get a handle on things. Your ears are such an important part of trying to find animals out here. Watch the bumps, don't spill your drinks. while we're driving along trying to find some hyenas, Colin, you'd like to know they're more scavengers or hunters? Colin, very good question. Excellent one. It depends basically on where they are in the world. So in East Africa, they'll do a lot more hunting, and in fact in some areas will hunt more than the lions do. Lions, of course, are just as efficient at scavenging as hyenas, and often they will scavenge more than hyenas do. No, Wendy, let's just stop. There we go. So Colin, great question. But the hyenas here will do more scavenging than they do hunting. They definitely forage alone. If they find something, they'll start shouting, just like Scott heard them doing. So they would have found something that excited them, either other hyenas or perhaps even an animal on a kill. But I can hear nothing here. Scott thought it was in this drainage line that runs down here. It's called the Mlulwati. Let's go to the next. We'll go to the next junction and maybe head a little bit up the drainage line. Thanks, Colin. That's a really good question. Hyenas, of course, are the most maligned animals in Africa because of that wonderful film, The Lion King. Unfortunately, it painted hyenas as cowardly scavengers, which they most certainly are not. Just on that theme of the hyenas, they kill by, it's a different strategy to lions. Lions, of course, like all the cats except the cheetah, are stalkers and then pouncers. They don't engage in a long-scale chase, whereas a hyena is a bit like a wild dog in that it will course after an animal and exhaust it to death and then sort of knock it over and tear it to pieces, not to put too fine a point on it. So they are coursers rather than sort of stalkers and pouncers. And you may or may not have seen that wonderful video that one of the rangers at Arethusa took of 17 or 18 hyenas chasing the Nkuhuma pride and I think it was a piece of the Shimungwe pride off a buffalo kill. And that, of course, is quite a common occurrence if the ratio favors the hyenas. And the ratio is generally at least 3 or 4 hyenas to 1 lioness. And if there's a male around, you may have seen the video, if there's a male around, probably 6 or 7 hyenas to 1 male lion. They'll be very nervous of a male lion. And if you haven't seen the video, just go and Google it. You'll find it on YouTube. It's incredible to watch those hyenas and how they react when Junior comes in. Junior is a... Oh, more leopard tracks here. Junior is a young male lion, part of the Nkuhuma pride. And he's starting to come into his own now. He's a big fellow. And the hyenas initially took enormous fright. I can't hear or see anything further down here. Been a hyena running down the road here. Let's just keep going a little way. And we'll come back up around the other side. Let's see what we can find. We're now on a road called Twin Dams. We're getting close to an area of the reserve called Twin Dams. Again, I don't know why it's called Twin Dams. There are no dams. Well, there's one dam there, but it's now a dust bowl. Very dry now. Okay. Drive a little bit quicker. more tracks on the road of hyenas, but the hyenas are running down this road. These are not walking. These are not walking tracks. The way I know they're not walking, is that they're running, is that they're totally indistinct. And the walking track, because the pad comes down on the ground and leaves an impression, and then the foot is lifted quite carefully, you can see it. But when they're running, the sand gets kicked up from the sides and the front. And so very indistinct tracks. It's very obvious when you know what to look for when an animal is running. Not down there. Keep going, we'll go down to Twin Downs and then we'll come up the other side. Still here, yeah. Still running down this road, fresh, fresh. And you know they're fresh because, again, because of how distinct they are. So it's very difficult to tell if a track that's running is fresh. Much easier if it's walking. It's on top. It's on top of all the other tracks. Dust Bowl. I don't see anything here. An entirely mammal-free zone at the moment. So nothing here. What we're going to do is turn around, or go around the little dust bowl, and head up the other side of the drainage line, the Mulawati drainage line, and see if we can't pick up something that side. It's quite a chilly morning. I mean, this is always the coldest part of the reserve that we're on, because it's the lowest point. So if the signal does get a bit jumpy, I'm sorry about that. It's because we're quite low down here. Right now on the southern boundary, so there's no point in trying to follow the hyena from here, because if it carried on in the same direction, it would have gone straight south, and we can't go there, of course. Very fresh smelling morning, very delicious. One or two subtle sweet smells of spring coming through. Spring, of course, officially starts tomorrow, but in the low veld tends to start a week earlier than the rest of the tree, simply because it's lower down and so just warmer a bit faster. We had one day of 36 degrees already, which is about 90, if I'm not mistaken, in Fahrenheit. Continuing along the subject of the lions and the hyenas, Natalie in California, you want to know if hyenas will ever manage to kill lions over a food conflict. Yeah, no, they can sometimes. It's not usual, but it does happen. If you ever have a chance, there's a magnificent film made by Derek and Beverly Joubert called Eternal Enemies. And it's about the fight between hyena and lions. And it's one of the iconic wildlife films of the age. It's an old film now, but it hasn't dated at all. Magnificent, magnificent film about the internal conflict that takes place between hyenas and lions. So I suggest strongly that if you're vaguely interested in the battle, I would go and get hold of that film and watch it. Lisa, you sound like you're a new viewer, which is wonderful to have you along. Thank you for sending a question through. You want to know, how many female lions there are on the property? Lisa, it's at any one time, it's difficult just to say, but there are two main prides that use Juma, this area, and Arethusa to the other side. And the main one, of course, is the Nkuhuma pride. And Kachina, John, you want to know if they're still on the property. I'm not sure. We haven't seen them yet, and I haven't seen tracks of them. I have seen one lion track, and it went off to the west. So we will eventually head around in that direction once we've exhausted trying to look around here where the male lion tracks were heading. And Lisa, in the Nkuhuma pride, there are four adult lionesses and two sub-adult lionesses. Now, I hope you don't lose our signal here. I'm just going to hold off talking until we're through this low area. Our signal seems to be stable, so that's good. And then Lisa, in the Styx pride, there were sort of three strange elements to it. It used to be one agglomeration, and then they sort of broke up into three, with two lionesses each. One of them was killed yesterday by the Birmingham Five, and so one of those breakaways is now only one lioness. So that's another five that sometimes come onto the reserve. We normally only see one of those breakaway prides though. And then there is the Shimungwe pride. As far as I understand it, how many females in the Shimungwe pride? I think it's only one or two. And they come on, I've never seen them. They come on sometimes from the north. So that gives you a vague idea, Lisa. Keep watching. It does change all the time. It becomes quite confusing, but it is always fascinating to see what the dynamics are. Interesting couple of questions from a brand new viewer whose name I'm struggling to catch. P-A-R-T-H Path. Path, I've never heard that name before. Welcome. You say you've stumbled across this website by mistake and you're a passionate wildlife enthusiast. Well, this is the place for you then. And you say that you don't know, you want to know how long this channel will carry on showing. Well, basically it's permanent, at least till the end of the year. So every day, twice a day, for 3 hours, you get to come on drive with us, live safari here in the Kruger National Park. You won't always have to look at me. Sometimes you'll be looking at animals. And sometimes, normally there are two vehicles out, and sometimes a walk as well. And we drive around here and see what we can find. Fortunately, one of our vehicles is in a state of disrepair at the moment. And then you say that you saw either some footage, I don't know, or perhaps you actually were there, at Londolozi, which is just down south of us here, where a female leopard ate her own cub after it was killed by a python. And you'd like that explained. Well, Path, the explanation that I can give you is simply that it's not entirely uncommon. I've seen lionesses eat their own cubs before. Not kill them, but eat them. And it's just a question of not wasting resources, eh? And I don't know if there's some kind of emotional attachment to it. We are unable at this stage to understand that depth of whether or not there is some kind of emotional attachment to the dead cub that makes them want to ingest it, or, yeah, I don't know. Certainly the traditional biological explanation would be that it is simply a desire not to waste good resources. So, I mean, there is nutrition in a dead cub, but I suspect there's probably a little bit more to it than that. But because we're unable to communicate properly with animals at this stage, some people seem to be able to do it, certainly better than others, but because most of us have to rely on what we see rather than what we can communicate, we don't know really what the extent of the emotional attachment would be to a cub. Certainly what's interesting, Park, I think, is that... Sorry, excuse me one second. Just checking the tracks here. Brian, that looks like a male leopard track with a hyena track on top of it. See that? Definitely. There's the male leopard. See that? Is he on top of the elephants or below the elephants? Just going to go a little bit further along here. We're basically coming, we've done full circle around the drainage line. I think this is the same male leopard, you know. I think we're going to turn, well, we're going to just go to the next drainage line, turn on and come back and see if we can't find this fellow. And I tell you why I'm so excited to see big adult male leopard tracks here, is that I think this is probably Mbula, and we haven't seen him for a long time. He hasn't been around for a little while yet. Perhaps if you, especially for our new viewers, we've spent quite a long time over the last week or so with a young male leopard, a year old, called Sindile. And Sindile is 12 months old, or just about, he's just over 12 months old, and in a precarious state of life because his mother is now mating again, much more early than we would expect, so we don't know about his fate. And obviously the biggest killer of male of leopard cubs is territorial males. But Mavis and Acadia, first of all, Acadia, I don't know, Shadow and Sandita were seen together 2 days ago. I don't know where they are now, but they're certainly a long way to the east of where we are, west of where we are now. And so this male leopard, Mavis, is probably not anywhere near where they are, unless they've come to the east, but I seriously doubt that would have happened. Right, I don't know what's going on with the hyenas. I'm going to turn around right here and just just continue following these male leopard tracks, which we found on the northern boundary, and they're now heading in an easterly direction. Looks like a territorial patrol. It is in Mvula's territory, so if we were to find him, I would be overwhelmed with excitement. But I'll try not to be overwhelmed on camera. Tricky following tracks in a car unless they're on the road. Thankfully these ones are on the road for now. Who knows how long they've been here. I suspect probably sometime this morning. Has managed to get the little bushwalk camera working. I'm not sure if he's on foot or with a vehicle, probably with a vehicle, and he's at the buffalo kill. And Jimelin in Oklahoma, you wanted to have a look at it. We'll go across there with Scott and I'll see you a bit later. I'll try and see if we can catch this male leopard.
Everyone, and welcome on board with myself, Scott, and Nicki is the camera lady this morning. We are on an abnormal vehicle because the other vehicle's broken, as I'm sure James has told you, and we've come to the remains of the Birmingham boys' buffalo kill, and it looks like there has been quite a lot of the meat that was not fed on yesterday has been consumed during the course of last night. And we did pop in for a few minutes at around 8:30, quarter to 9 last night, and we did see one hyena currently feeding on it at that stage, and we saw another two at the Gallagher waterhole, which is not far from here, and I think they'd already had their full and gone to the waterhole to have a drink and relax. So there certainly has been some activity here last night. But take a closer look at the carcass. You'll see that it's been swiveled around completely. Where the bottom is now, its head, you see, and a lot of the meat has been consumed. So there's not too much. And some parts that are hard to get to have been left, but important thing to remember is maybe the hyena that found this kill didn't call any other hyena and kept it as their own little surprise or treat. There's only so much one hyena eats. And I could well come back and continue to eat on it. There's still a lot in there, and I'm hoping that they will come in speeding on this buffalo again once it's warmed up a little bit. It hasn't been light for very long, and I think a little bit later they will come down and be able to access points of this carcass that have now been opened up by the hyena that fed on it last night. Another interesting fact that we cannot be sure of is the potential chance of a leopard coming into this kill. It wasn't long ago that a zebra died of natural causes on Buffalo's Hook, and lion, leopard and hyena all fed on that kill over about 2 days, taking turns. The leopard was there on the first afternoon. It was the first animal on the kill. The zebra had died of natural causes, and Mvula was there first. Some of you may have seen the grisly video of him ripping open his stomach, the first opening he made, and a whole huge amount of stomach juices came shooting out of the zebra's stomach, and Mvula got such a fright he jumped backwards. Anyway, he fed on it for a while, then a hyena came in that night, and the following morning he was still seen feeding on it. Then a lion came in, chased Mvula up a tree, then the lion left, and Mvula came back down, fed some more, and then hyena came back that night. So a lot of interesting scenarios can happen at kills like this, and simply because we haven't been here, we don't know exactly who has been feeding on this kill. We're gonna let Nicki take you in for one more closer look. And second back to Jane, I'm not sure what could have caused the crazy vocalization we heard earlier this year. And that's why I radioed James and got him to shoot into that area of Twin Dams and the Mowati. But they must have been chasing something, because you could hear the oil moving at a rapid from, it's like, further away. And I'm wondering if any of you guys maybe heard anything on the Juma waterhole cam. There was a series of really interesting hyenas. Now, Nicki and I are probably going to wait here for a while and see if any creatures don't come down. And failing that, we may head off and search in another area of Juma. Hopefully we could try and find the Inkahuma Pride or anything really to help James out on his morning safari. Enjoy. We're going to send you back to him, and we will hopefully find something interesting for you a little bit later.
Hello everybody, welcome back. Tracks of male leopard heading down this road. But where he could be, I don't know. We'll just drive very gently along here and see what we can find. I'm just going to keep an eye out on the road there. Quite thick bush. Anyway, we'll see what happens. Would nice be nice at this stage, I feel, to see any kind of mammal life. So you've got a good idea there of how much meat the hyenas have taken off that buffalo. And we were very concerned, well, not concerned, we were all wondering yesterday why on earth it hadn't been destroyed to a greater extent. The hyenas are now, I think they've taken most of what they will take from it. Probably a few more will come through. I don't think that the clan that operates the den, which is very close to that kill, I don't think it's that big, you know. I think in the clan that stole the kill from the Nkuhuma Pride a couple of days ago, about a week ago, I think they'd have made short work of that buffalo. I'm just going to talk to Craig quickly on the radio. Negative Craig, we haven't found any tracks yet. Anyway, we might just stop and have a bit of a listen here, catch our breath. Ah, wonderful to have the African sun on my face. Just have a listen and see what we can hear. Crested Franklins endlessly. More bearded woodpeckers. Grey-headed bushshrike. And that tree that you're looking at is a magnificent example of Balanites magami. I always like that name. Balanites, and that's a torchwood, a green thorn, and you can see the tremendously fluted nature of the branches and the stem. By fluted I mean not sort of straight,
like a knobthorn or a marula would be. You can see it's twisted. Really is a beautiful morning. Right. In the absence of being able to go off on foot, I think what we're going to do is probably just, we'll carry on this road and see if we can't pick up the tracks. And I think we're going to leave the area because he's been on a territorial mark. It's very difficult to say how far he would have gone. Maybe we'll be lucky. If not, I think we should probably head off to the west and see if we can't pick up tracks of the Ngohuma pride and whatever else happens to be on our route. Now here is a magnificent question as we drive along looking for male leopard. Sarah in California, there's a nyala, Brian. Look, it's hiding from us behind a tree. We wouldn't see it. We have spotted it. Don't say when. Right. So just while we look at that nyala into the blazing sun, you can just see it. Hiding from us. That is our second mammal sighting of the day. Beautiful nyala ewe or cow. They can be ewe or cow. Sarah, your question is, why is it or how is it that a male leopard knows his cub? How is it that, despite the fact that he is nowhere near her, the mother, during the birth, that he knows it's his cub? Sarah, the answer is difficult to give, and I'm not really sure that anyone knows for sure. Most importantly, I'm not very sure that the male leopard is actually being truthfully... I'm not sure that there isn't quite a lot of untruth in the female's ways, and I'll tell you what I mean by that. Infanticide is one of the major killers of leopard cubs, lion cubs, and in fact a huge number of mammals, including our own species. Human beings, certainly in Stone Age societies, used to engage in quite extensive infanticide. And that infanticide, for those of you who don't know, basically means males, unrelated men or males, killing youngsters that are not their own. And it's not uncommon in mammals. Oh, there's a lovely little calf there. So, Sarah, in order to finish that discussion, what I need to say is that Shadow, for example, who is Sindila's mother, has been seen mating with two different male leopards. Now, it's possible that she has mated with Tingana, in whose territory she lives, and in whose territory Sindila lives. It's possible that she has mated with another male, conceived with another male, who's perhaps a superior physical specimen, like perhaps the Anderson male, and come across, but because she's mated with Tingana, Tingana becomes convinced that the cub being raised in his territory is in fact his. But there's no way to tell whether that is the case unless we do some DNA analysis. And we are collecting dung at the moment in order to find out exactly who is who. We have what we think is a good idea, but I think eventually when we hand over the DNA samples or when the DNA results come back, I think that we will be astonished to find out some of the different paternity that is going on in this area. And it's basically the same principle as the cuckold, where in human beings, what might happen certainly in a I don't want to use the term primitive, but in societies that are not encumbered by Western norms, shall we say, the concept of cuckolding, where a woman will marry a man for security and then conceive a child with another man who is perhaps a superior physical specimen, is very, very common. And it actually happens more commonly
in Western society than you think it does. Now, I find that absolutely fascinating, and we're often looking at animals and wondering whether, you know, we tend to anthropomorphize them and put our human emotions and our human behaviors onto them. That's one of them that is very common to us and very common to many mammal species. So interesting one. Thank you, Sarah, for sparking that. On from that discussion, Marianne, you say you've read quite a lot about leopards and infanticide, and you say that of all the mammal species, leopards engage in infanticide possibly more than any other species. Marianne, I think that that is probably the case. And you say it's poorly understood. It's much better understood than it used to be, and it's mainly better understood here in the Sabi Sands because of people like us and you watching all the time and gathering information, and then tourists. You know, there are a huge number of tourism lodges out here, which means that we watch leopards here. You know, a leopard doesn't go without being seen here for more than a week. And so we've got a constant idea of where they are and what they're doing. I mean, not always, but we've got a general idea of what's happening. And we know for sure that the number one killer of leopard cubs is other leopards. We know that. It is poorly understood. I think that if we look at it through the lens of paternity and the lens that I've just presented to you through sort of cuckolding and trying to make sure that males don't kill cubs that they don't think are their own, I think it becomes a lot more clearly understood. But we'll see going forward. Thank you, Marianne. We're going to carry on. The Nyala have headed off into the bush. Very beautiful antelope. My favorite antelope out here. Apparently, just going back to what I was saying about cuckolding, which is not necessarily a very pleasant human subject, but it is very interesting if you're able to detach yourself from it emotionally. They've done all sorts of paternity tests in sophisticated Western society in America and the UK and Europe and various other places. And apparently, the percentage of men raising children that are not their own, without their knowledge, is, I don't know exactly what the percentage is, but it's far higher than you think it is, which means that cuckolding is something of a human tradition, stretching way back into our evolutionary past. I suspect that it happens a lot more in the animal kingdom than we think it does, especially with something like leopards. So the more males that Shadow can convince into believing that she's conceived their cubs, the greater the security of her next generation, of her next litter. That sort of stage in the morning when it feels like everything's calming down, that air of expectation of the early dawn starting to dissipate as the heat starts to build. That's not to say that we won't find anything, but it just does, the atmosphere really does change. There's a very subtle change in the energy. So we're going to head off to the west now towards Treehouse Dam, see if we can't find some evidence of the Nkokuma pride, where they may or may not have been during the night. There's not much else. No one else is driving around Juma at the moment, so we don't really know what's around. That's why the radio has been very quiet from that point of view. Beautiful starling on the was on the road now. Now flying at Mach 3 towards the north. There it is, Brian. On top of the tree there. A Birchall's starling. Fortunately a little bit backlit, which means you're not getting quite the full extent of its amazing iridescent purple and blue feathers. It's one of three glossy starlings of similar colour that we get here. The Birchall's, Cape glossy and greater blue eared are the others. There it goes. Down to eat some insects. They will eat, they've got a very kind of what we call a Catholic diet, where they will eat seeds and insects and possibly a bit of fruit even. If they can get them though, insects are the thing to get, especially this time of the year when seeds are a bit short, in short supply. And insects of course are very fatty, and so they give birds have a tremendous energy need, but mainly for to maintain heat of course, because they're warm-blooded. And also flying is not an energy efficient activity unless you're soaring like a vulture, in which case you use almost no energy. There he is again. Don't fly anywhere. There you get an idea of the magnificent blue, green and purple colours. Isn't that lovely? And that bird looks almost totally black when not in the sun. And then it goes into the sun and it looks like a sort of metallic array of astonishing colours. Where they hop. Bloop. I seem to have unplugged myself. There, plugged back in. Why are they iridescent is the question coming through. Well, we know that it's not for mating, and we know that it's not for mating because both the males and the females have the same color. So in species where that isn't the case, so the sunbirds, where the males are beautifully colored and the females tend to be fairly drab, we know that the males are so colored because, or like a peacock, because that's how they attract females, and that's a whole nother discussion. But why something like a virtual starling is that color versus brown is difficult to say. I think that that color, I don't know. Why is a lilac-breasted roller lilac-breasted as opposed to plain colored? Because again, there's no sexual dimorphism there. And the main adaptation for different colors and sizes normally has to do with trying to breed. And that's just not the case with birds of similar, when they're sort of similarly colored. I don't know. I'm gonna think about it. I couldn't tell you why a virtual starling is iridescent purple and green and blue rather than a plain brown. Have something to do with heat balance. You know, they are dark, and so that's, and because maybe that metallic color, because of the darkness, helps to reflect light, which makes them a bit cooler. I'm not sure. What have we got, Brian? There's a green pigeon flying away. Well spotted, Brian. You got him there. Go a little bit forward. So here's a green pigeon, same story. No sexual dimorphism in the green pigeon. Males and females, same color, we don't know why. There's another brightly colored bird on that tree called a crested barbet. There's also a golden-tailed woodpecker that just called there. This is a huge party going on here. So Brian, if you go to the right, you'll see the barbet, I think. I may have parked you right behind it. No, there it is in the middle. That's it. So crested barbet, beautiful yellow and red and white, scruffy bird. But again, male and female, same. Why are they the same? Why the color? Why the energy expenditure to make the bird that color? I don't know. And that other bird there, that's not a virtual starling. That's a smaller one, but it's, again, it's a glossy starling. Probably the greater blue-eared glossy starling. Now lurking behind the bush there. So very good question there. Why the energy expenditure on the extra color? No idea. I can't think of any evolutionary reason for it, to be honest. And they're all hopping around on that tree looking for insects. And there are two fruitarians in that tree. The green pigeon and the barbet would both rather have fruit if they can get it, but at this time of the year, like I say, fruit is in very short supply. So they will take anything they can get that will give them the energy that they need to survive in this sometimes harsh environment. Let us continue on our quest, pottering through the wild. We've been talking about cuckolding and the interesting, if somewhat disturbing, subject thereof. And Lenny in Arizona, you want to know, and this is a very good question, why is it, or is it possible, that in a lion litter that the cubs can have more than one father? I mean, obviously every individual cub can only have one father, but in a litter of six, if she is mated with more than one male, is it possible that there's some kind of multi-paternity? Lenny, it's unlikely in lions, and I'll tell you why it's unlikely in lions, because normally when a female comes into estrus, she will mate with only one of the coalition males. Now, it's a little bit different for lions and leopards, because for a lion, they live in a pride, and the male coalition is normally related males, which means that their need to perpetuate genes within is covered by their brothers mating with the females in the area. So they don't tend to compete over mating rights. They tend to, if a female comes into estrus, one male will mate with her until she's finished her estrus. So it's unlikely that there's this multi-paternity. In leopards, we don't know. It's definitely been recorded in cheetahs, where cheetahs in a different cheetahs in a litter have different fathers, which is fascinating. Again, probably avoids infanticide. Leopards, we don't know. Nobody's managed to do a test yet. And that's why the gathering of the DNA is so important. So Lenny, a very good question. Leopards, we don't know. Lions, it's unlikely. Cheetah, it definitely has been recorded. those of you who perhaps just joined us an hour and a half into the drive, Sherry, and this cover will cover Sherry's question. A lioness was killed from the Styx Pride yesterday by the Birmingham males. Now, this is slightly strange behavior, and Sherry, you want to know if this was the lioness that was seen mating with Hairy Belly, the Matimba male, a little while back. I've got no way of knowing, I'm afraid, Sherry. I don't know. It's quite possible. I don't think the fact that she was mating with the Matimba lioness had anything to do with it, unless she was pregnant and therefore wanted to try and sort of get away from them or protect her pregnancy. I'm not sure. It's really difficult to say. We haven't actually seen the lioness, of course. It's happened all south of us, unfortunately. So, Sherry, I'm afraid I can't tell you if it was the pregnant lioness or even if she was pregnant. You've asked a question, and I think you've made it unintentionally complicated, but and in so doing, very interesting. You've said, what will the other female, the remaining Styx female and her remaining cub do? Will they maybe join up with the other Styx prides, which they broke away from a little while back? Or will they just give up and eventually join the Birmingham boys? They can't join the Birmingham boys. Remember that the pride males are not part of the pride. The Birmingham boys will dominate a number of different prides. The pride is the females and the cubs. So they can't join the Birmingham boys intentionally. The Birmingham boys are busy taking over their territory, or taking over the Matimba's territory in which the Styx pride territories reside. So they don't really have a choice in the matter. They can't go away somewhere else. They can't disappear into some other lion pride's territory, because that pride will chase them out. So unfortunately, the choice that they have is very limited indeed. Heading down towards Treehouse Waterhole. Seeing if we can't find signs of the Impala pride or any mammal at this stage. Interesting question from Nishant. Nishant, I think you might be a new viewer, which is wonderful. Thank you for your comment and your question. You want to know if Asiatic lions show the same sorts of behavioral patterns in terms of pride takeovers and that sort of thing. Nishant, I don't know for sure, but it is the same species. The Asiatic lion forest of India is the same species. So whether it shows the same behavior or not, I'm not sure, but I would imagine that it does. Very few Asiatic lions left, and of course lions extended all the way into Europe until about 500 AD in some places. Absolutely nothing going on at Treehouse Dam. It's distressing. I'm just going to quickly get hold of Craig. Craig, can you go again with that last message? We're going to survey this puddle of mud, and while we're doing that, the good news is that Scott has headed off on his little Mahindra off to the hyena den, and it is still active, so we'll pop across to him and see what else is going on at the hyena den. See you just now.
Everybody, and we've lucky when we arrived at the hyena den, there was nobody home, and we thought we'd just wait here for a few moments to see if anything changes. And thankfully, it was a couple of we had to wait for one youngster arrived, and it's coming like a puddle of urine, which you can see trickling below its front legs, and it was before it got there. So possibly the adults came and left some information for the youngsters at the den. And those of you who have been playing the show for some time now, you probably would have read seeing similar in patches at the or around the den sites. And that's like just an interesting communicatory information. It's there for a reason. There's a message left in the sand there that I'm guessing only the hyena can read. And this young cub is literally rolling itself in, reading the newspaper, you'd almost say, with its nose. Let's see if it does call out the young cub. Or is it just going to disappear? Well, at least you guys got a glimpse of that hyena in the vehicle that we are sitting in. It's a regular game viewing vehicle that's very, very long and difficult to maneuver. But I'm told the audio is not working too well. Apologies, we are just testing using the backpack, so it's not the regular kind of transmitting that we'll do to you or broadcasting, and because you can't hear me too well, we are gonna send back to James. But happy that you got to at least see one hyena this morning. There's been a lot of chats about hyena and the buffalo carcass, so at least you've seen one. We're going to a better area, hopefully signal one, try and work out what's going on with the audio issues, and catch up with you all a little bit later.
Hello everybody, welcome back to Wendy, where we are still at Treehouse Dam, where a great plethora of nothing has come down to drink, and we're going to head off towards the west and see if we can't find where the Nkuhuma Pride was last night. Yes, not a huge array of mammals out this morning, but we're going to carry on, forge ahead, full of fortitude and courage, and see what we can see. Oops, I've kicked myself out. There we go. You can see I have removed my jersey. It has become quite warm, which is very nice. While you were away from us, I was speaking to Craig Craig is from Cheetah Plains, and he said that he had tracks of the Birmingham males heading north again to the east of this property. I think that probably means they're on Biffle's Hook, but we will eventually head around that way too. Now what's interesting about that is that they're not sticking in one place for any length of time at all. They're moving constantly, 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 and that is just a great sign of their intentions to take over a territory. It's also a sign if they're moving like that, there will be in a state of tension quite a lot of the time, and that I think is probably why they killed that lioness yesterday. Speed so that we cannot see them. Ah, there is one beautiful little fellow. Brian, when it's not going for you, it's just not going for you. There we go. That's of course the fastest dwarf mongoose in history. Oh, there are a whole lot of them on that little termite mound there. I'm just going to sneak forward. Ah, dwarf mongoose. You didn't get the memo about hiding from us today, did you? Mm-mm. There you are. Look, the last one is now disappearing into the termite mound. We're going to sit here and just see if they don't come out, because they can be quite confiding. I'm going to do something slightly... Here comes another one, Brian, from the left. There we go. They're coming out now. So sometimes if you make a little slight bird alarm call, they'll come out. And then just a... while we're looking at these dwarf mongoose, I'm going to answer two more questions about infanticide and lions and leopards. Path, our new viewer, who clearly knows a lot about what's going on in the Sabi Sands, said, first of all, how many lions... Oh, look at that little thing coming towards us now. How many lions from the Mapoho made it to adulthood? Path, I'm afraid I don't know. I was in the Sabi Sands when the Mapoho pride or the Mapoho males came in, and then I didn't hang around for a long time, and then I was away, and when I got back they had been replaced. So I don't know exactly how many of them survived, but I will say that only 1 in 10 or so male lions will make it, not so much to adulthood, but to territoriality. So to about 6 or 7 years when they're able to take a territory. In the case of the Birminghams, of course, they're a bit younger than that, but that's because it's a large coalition. There's a lovely little sighting of dwarf mongoose. Nervous little dwarf mongoose wanting to come out there. And then we had another question about whether Sindile would show the same instinct to kill cubs. And if Shadow has new cubs, she's just been mating, and this question is from Catherine, would Sindile then try to kill some or the new cubs? Catherine, It's unlikely. Remember, he will... Well, first of all, certainly not at this stage. He's too young. He's not, his testosterone levels are nowhere near those of a territorial male leopard. They're also his kin, and they do tend to show some kind of sibling kin recognition. So the chances of him killing any new cubs are extremely small. I don't know what the mechanism of kin recognition is. I suspect it's got a lot to do with a pheromonal effect. And it's the same way. Remember how powerful a leopard's olfactory senses are. Incredibly powerful sense of smell, incredibly sensitive sense of smell. Now, you know, as a human being, how familiar your mother and father smelt, and perhaps your siblings smelt. And that familiarity is a pheromonal familiarity that you are picking up on. Now, imagine that you had a nose as sensitive as a leopard's. How easy almost it would be to tell whether an animal was kin. I'm not sure that the same follows for males to youngsters, though. The dwarf mongoose, let's have a little chat about them, are the smallest carnivores we get out here. They live in a little troop that centers on a termite mound like the one they're living in now. The termite mound will be inactive in terms of termites at the moment. It may be recolonized at some stage, but right now there are no termites living in it. And the dwarf mongoose will use it as a refuge, as a central refuge, and they'll have a number of other little refuges around their little territory that they can all leap into should a bird or a snake or something come around that threatens them. They'll eat any kind of meat, basically, that they can get hold of. Mainly insects and reptiles and that sort of thing. They will eat eggs, too, if they can get them. And they have a very interesting method, not so much the dwarf mongoose, but certainly the banded mongoose, of breaking eggs. What they do is that they line up a stone behind them and then fling the egg through their back legs, which of course cracks the egg open. Brian, just to the right of that, you see these two little chaps coming out quite close to us here. There we go. Look at that. So sweet. Termite mound is the ideal little refuge for a mongoose, or any animal really, except if you're trying to escape snakes. Not easy. And you'll find that all of their senses are excellent. Their hearing is good, their sight is very good, and their smell especially powerful. There's a two little youngsters. Talk to Scott. Scott, those tracks eventually go south down Vulture's Nest. We followed them this morning. And to me, one of the most interesting thing about dwarf mongoose, before we carry on from here, is that they are very similarly social structured to wild dogs, where they've got an alpha pair that do most of the breeding, and then a beta pair that will sometimes breed, but the rest of them just help with raising the youngsters and looking after the troop. And much like with wild dogs, the dispersal case is that they will go off in sort of separate groups. So males will go somewhere else, and then females will go somewhere else, and they'll meet up with females and males of other troops and start their own little troops. And that happens when they're adults and when they hit puberty and they, well, once they've gone past puberty and they're ready to start breeding. Beautiful little sighting. And they also, my last thing I'm going to say about them is that they have a very kind of a relaxed way of life. They don't like to strain themselves too much. They get up late with the sun. They don't get up before dawn. They come up and they warm themselves like they're doing now. Then they'll go out and forage for a while. They'll rest in the heat of the day, and as it gets cooler, they'll forage again. And then by sunset, they're all on the mound again in the last of the sun's rays, and then they'll disappear as soon as it gets dark down to the termite mound to sleep. So they don't tend to have a very stressful life. They keep very civilized hours. They really are very sweet little creatures. They're one of four mongoose species that we get here. White-tailed, the banded, and the slender being the others. Right, let us continue. There are tracks of the Nkuhuma pride now. Lex Hess has found them just to the east of us, west of us, and they are heading sort of this direction. So that's where we're going to go. Just onto the mongoose social structure. Siberia Zumi, you want to know, do they have the same social structure as hyena? It depends entirely on the mongoose, really. The male, they don't actually, the dwarf mongoose doesn't, no. They've got a much more similar social structure to wild dogs. Remember, hyenas have got a matriarchal clan society where the females are bigger and the clan is led by females. By a big alpha female or a big matriarch, they call her. Now the dwarf mongoose are like wild dogs where they've got an alpha pair, a dominant male and female pair that will do most of the breeding and they will lead the troop. And so very like wild dogs, not very much like hyenas. And certainly there are no mongoose species that I know of that have a matriarchal society. They're not that distantly related to hyenas though, which is quite interesting. And then from Gloria, where are the wild dogs? Gloria, I've got no idea. Rest assured that if I did know, I'd be with them and you'd be viewing them with us now. What I can tell you is that they're not on Juma. We have had various people doing the boundaries, so I'm afraid they're not around at the moment, which is very distressing and sad. I think, I really couldn't tell you. We haven't seen them for now, probably 2 weeks. I imagine though, Gloria, our sightings will get a little bit better in the next little while because of course they are no longer in the dens. Well, they'll be sort of in their dens now, but very soon the pups that were born this year will start to move with the pack, and that means that the packs will start to move a greater distance than they would normally, or than they would during the winter when they're denning, and that means that the chances of them coming over Juma are much higher. Talking about smell and sight, and we were talking about the pheromonal component of kin recognition. And Kevin in Boston, you want to know which animals use smell the most out of any of the others. And Kevin, I don't know the answer for sure, but I will say to you that the hyenas have an incredibly powerful sense of smell. I think they use their noses to find carcasses possibly more than other animals do. All the animals out here have very sensitive senses of smell though. And you say you're under the impression that elephants have the most sensitive sense of smell. I don't know for sure. They definitely have very sensitive sense of smell, especially as their eyes are not, don't tend to be as good as, say, a leopard or a lion's. I think their sight is better than many people think it is, though. I've certainly never been able to sneak past an elephant without it being seeing me. So, elephants, yes, definitely very good sense of smell. Are they the strongest sense of smell? I would say no. I would say that would have to go to some of the carnivores that rely on scavenging. You are a relatively new viewer, and you'd like to see, you say you've been watching for 3 weeks. Well, I'm glad that we've managed to arrest your attention for that period, and I'm very grateful for your 3 weeks. Thank you. Please keep watching. And you'd like to, you say we haven't spent much time with vervet monkeys, and could we spend some more time with them? Marilyn, the thing with the monkeys, absolutely, if we find them in the wild, we'll definitely spend some time with them. The thing is that they tend to hang around the camps, and because they are extremely good at pilfering bits and pieces to eat, especially during the winter time when there is perhaps less in the way of fruit and other food in the bush. They tend to hang around the camp. So I suspect we'll spend more time with them in the wild during the summer months when there's fruit around and they're looking, perhaps they're eating in the jackalberries and they're spending a bit more time feeding on insects and things like that that are out here. Then a shunt. Also a new viewer, you want to know about snakes and do we get lots of snakes out here and are any of them venomous? But Nashant, I think you will find that there are a huge number of snakes out here, but we don't see that many. And that's not surprising. Snakes will avoid human contact as much as they can. And so some of the most common ones would be puff adders. They have a cytotoxic venom, and we see them relatively regularly. Then, of course, some of the cobras, the snouted cobra and the Mozambican spitting cobra, some of the more spectacular cobras. And of the iconic, if slightly notorious, black mamba is also a common snake out here. Large, obviously highly venomous, and they are also found here in relative abundance. But we don't see them often, and that's because they do avoid us. They don't like people. They know we're the apex predator. And so the only time that people get into trouble with snakes is if they are harassing the snakes. Animals, Brian?
I have no idea.
Brian is starting to look a little disconcerted, I must say, by the lack of mammal life that we've managed to pick up today. I don't blame him. There's nothing around. Staring longingly into the bush. Very nice to find Sindile around here. This is where we were watching him over the last little while. there's some very interesting comments on the olfactory senses coming through. Linda, first of all, you say you know, you've heard, you're sure that wild dogs have a very strong sense of smell. Absolutely, definitely they do. Natalie, you've hit on something that's very interesting. You said you've heard that vultures have got a very powerful olfactory sense in their brain. Natalie, where in the world are you? I don't mean that facetiously. I'd really like to know which part of the world you come from. And I believe you're from California. And now what's interesting about that is that in California, absolutely, your vultures in the New World have got a very strong olfactory part of the brain. And they certainly use smell extensively to find their carrion prey. The Old World vultures, where we are, don't. They use sight predominantly to find their prey. And the one animal that is different here, and in fact our vultures are not very closely related to yours. One of the animals that is, or one of our birds that is more closely related, is something called a marabou stork. And they are carrion eaters that find their prey largely through smell. Our vultures do it almost exclusively through sight. And so very different New World and Old World vultures. I suspect it's got something to do with the fact that the Old World vultures, certainly in South America, live over very thick bush, and so they need to be able to smell through the forest canopy. Whereas here, it's obviously a bit more open, and our vultures, which fly at an astonishing height, are able to see the kills, and they follow each other down to kills. They follow other carrion-seeking birds that fly a bit lower down to kills, and it's all done on sight. I'm sure they can smell, but nothing like the Old World, the New World vultures. Thanks, Natalie. Very nice question. And very nice little discussion topic. Just in case you're wondering what the Old World versus the New World is. The New World is basically the Americas, North and South America, and the Old World consists of Africa, Europe, and Asia. I'm not sure where Antarctica fits into that. Amanda in Alabama, you were obviously around this morning, and we went to the buffalo kill, and certainly Scott was there. No vultures. Why are there no vultures there? And that's a good question. And was I surprised? No, I wasn't, and I'll tell you why, is that the vultures came in great numbers yesterday. They ate what they could, and then they moved off. Remember, they can't get into some of the pieces of that carcass. So they ate what they could get, and then they've moved off to see what else they can find. They might come back, certainly. I haven't seen a huge number of vultures at Juma, and I find it slightly worrying. But yes, they ate what they could, and then they seemed to move off. Just going to keep driving up this road here. And then Fiona, just on the subject of vultures, do we get leopard-faced vultures here? Absolutely we do. They're one of five species we get here. The other ones being the white-backed vulture, which is very common. And then we get the hooded vulture, which is the smaller one, with a kind of spiky beak. And then we get a white-headed vulture, which is unusual. And what I'm gonna do is stop here and I'll show you the different pictures of them. Because there's nothing else to look at out here. Is there, Brian? No, nothing. Except there's some spring leaves, it would seem, on that tree over there. So in case our viewers haven't seen enough in the way of vegetation for the day. There seems to be, there's a cambrium bush there that's got some spring leaves on it. I'll go and pick them for you just now. Once I've shown you the vultures.
here are the vultures that we get here.
Oh, decent. Yes. There is the leopard-faced vulture, of which Fiona was asking. The one of the biggest vultures here, second largest. Then there's the white-headed, very rare vulture. Then there's the hooded, which is the smallest one, normally the first vulture to the carcass. And then there is the most common is the African white-backed vulture. That's this chap here. And he's got a white back. That's why he's called a white-backed vulture, obviously. And that white back is actually an important adaptation. It reflects the sun.
And so they follow each other by watching the reflected sun off the back. They follow each other down to carcasses. And then my favorite one is this one here, the Cape Griffin vulture. And that's him there. He looks very much like the white-backed vulture. He is the biggest. He can get bigger than the leopard-faced. 115 centimeters. That's about a meter, just over a meter tall, which is pretty tall. I mean, that is from the dashboard here, that is, it's about that big. Huge, huge bird. And beautiful honey-colored eye. So those are the five vultures that we get here. Right. Okay, what I'm going to do is get out of the car and go and fetch you some of those spring leaves. I'm going to get out of the car rather than drive there, because if I have to sit in the seat for much longer, I'm going to go stark raving insane. So you like to see mammal life frolicking in the wild. I am now going to frolic over to that tree and then return frolicking back with some leaves.
Watch me frolic, Brian.
Splendid, James, splendid.
These are new red bush willow leaves, and I think that this tree is abnormal because these leaves are not that young, but they're certainly from the new season. But I think they've been burnt slightly by, well, they've been eaten by a few insects, but they've definitely, they're dry. It's like it's too soon for them to have been, too soon for them to have been produced. And I'm just going to have a taste of them, because Combretum leaves do tend to be very heavily tanninized, especially the young ones. They are quite tannin rich. They're actually not as tanniny as the older ones. That's interesting. So I suspect they'll probably be eaten as soon as they come out, these young Combretum leaves. Right, that is Combretum apiculatum, the most common bush willow we get out here. It's not the most common tree. No mammal life at all. We should continue. Now I need to plug myself in, lest I fail to hear the dulcet tones of Tara Dales. Go. Brian, impala. Good heavens. Here we go, everybody. I knew we'd find a great plethora of mammals eventually. Here we have some male impala, seemingly the most common antelope in Juma. Today, rarer than the sable antelope. They, of course, are not always friends. In fact, they're normally not. They're often not friends, and that's normally around beginning of the year when their testosterone levels go through the roof, and they fight with each other in their attempt to dominate the herds of females that they will eventually mate with in May. Now, the females of which we have not seen one today, which is something of an astonishing fact. In fact, it's more unusual not to see them than it is to see them. And they will all be pregnant at this stage, and they will be waiting for November when the rains come with any luck, and then they will produce their babies. And it's always a wonderful sort of celebratory time, not only for us, but it's also for the predators, come the end of November when the young lambs are dropped, because there really are a plethora of them. You wouldn't say so given the number of impala we've seen today, but I promise there are lots around. Right, let's continue. Scott is on the trail of the Nkuhuma pride. He is following them with Lex. They haven't managed to come up with anything yet. No doubt, by this time of the day, those lions will be sleeping with a great profoundness. Still, it would be nice to see them, wouldn't it, Brian? Plenty of zebra tracks on the road. The zebras are also hiding. Grief, look at that, Brian, they're more impala. Female impala this time. Let's see if we can see a sign of pregnancy. Yeah, I think you can, you know. She's starting to show. Yeah, that belly is that size because of pregnancy. You can just see her hips are also starting to show a little bit, and that's because they're obviously nutritionally stressed at this stage of the year, but definitely pregnant. And making their way away from us like all the mammals at Juma. Brian, why is the universe spitting upon us today? Any idea?
Nothing at the moment, sorry.
Did you think evil thoughts when you got up this morning?
Quite excited for
this ride. Yeah, I was extremely excited. Then we found the leopard tracks, we heard hyenas yelling, and we found cambrium trees. I was talking about old world vultures and their olfactory senses, and now and their relatives, the marabou storks, which live out here. And Jane in Colorado, you interestingly, there are lion tracks here, but I think they're the older ones. They're heading towards that way there. Jane, you say they terrify you. I don't think they need to terrify you at all. They're certainly not the most attractive birds that we have out here, but they're not particularly frightening, I don't believe. And your question is how, with a beak like they have. Now, they have a very kind of long, stalkish beak. You can imagine a stork's beak, and I'm not going to show you a picture. It's a bit thicker than most stork's beaks, but you want to know how they eat flesh like that. Do they just pick off small pieces, or how do they do it? They don't only eat carrion. They will eat fish. We've certainly seen them eating catfish in some of the little waterholes that are drying out now. And they will. What they'll do with that beak is it's not hooked and sort of ideally suited to tearing the last remnants of meat off a carcass, but when there is rotting meat, that beak's quite effective at just pulling it off and taking it off in quite large chunks.
have I spotted a warthog in grass so thick that I believe the Hubble Space Telescope would struggle to see it and deliver a picture to the screen. No, not a warthog, a stump. Never mind. No doubt if it had been a warthog, it would have run away from us at a great speed, in accordance with the general memo that all mammals have received this morning. Quite a lot about that buffalo kill. And Ruth in California, nice question, how long before animals are able to tell that it's too bad for them to eat? Ruth, the answer is that animals can eat it until it's gone, until there are only bones remaining. And that eventually, I mean, that the last bits of meat will be eaten by ants. Birds will certainly spend quite a long time before that eating it. Flies and maggots, fly larvae, which, and there were lots of them on the carcass yesterday, will devour quite a lot of it, and it never gets that bad. It never gets, well, no, it gets, I mean, certainly you and I wouldn't go near it, but animals out here have evolved digestive systems that allow them to eat just about any form of rotting flesh, and that means that nothing goes to waste out here. So it never gets too bad for animals to eat. It never gets to the extent that it's so rank that nothing will eat it. The most rank thing I ever found was a honey badger dead the other day. That it's the first time I've ever actually gagged at a carcass. Yes, there are lots of times when I've been at a carcass that doesn't smell delicious, but I've never gagged before. But that honey badger was eventually eaten 2 days later. We don't really know what ate it. It seemed like hyenas had actually been rolling in it and they'd burst it open, but after that the birds got in and ate quite a lot of it. So yeah, but on that front, certainly a honey badger dead, Brent has seen a few of them, and predators will avoid them. So there definitely, Ruth, is a sense of what is edible and what is not edible. Now, I'm just trying to decide what the best route is from here. The lions, it would seem, are in this area here. So I think we'll go left. Slightly personal questions. By personal, I don't mean personal. I just mean about me and about South Africa in general. The first one, the name I'm finding difficult to get, but I will get it eventually. Camp Soul Cat. Definitely not the name your parents gave you, unless they were possibly residents of a hippie colony in the 60s. But Camp Soul Cat, a nice question about languages in South Africa and what languages are taught. At the moment, everybody who goes to school has to learn English and one African language. Now, an African language can actually include French, because we have Francophone areas of
of Africa. But mainly what it means in South Africa is one of our other 11 official languages. One of them is Afrikaans, that's the other European language, which is a sort of pidgin Dutch, if you like. Then a much less complicated version of Dutch. Then the other indigenous languages are some beautiful ones, like Zulu, Ndebele, Siswati, and Xhosa. They form a group called the Nguni languages, and then there are the Sotho languages, Sipedi, Sesotho, and what's the other one, Brian? Oh, Setswana. And then there's a totally unrelated language called Venda. And Shivenda is apparently, to non-Venda speakers, one of the most difficult languages to learn. And then there's Tsonga, or Shitsonga, or Shangaan, which is the language that we speak around here. And it's sort of related to the Nguni languages, but is distantly so. So those are the languages we learned here. And I did Zulu at school. We had to do Afrikaans back in those days. In the bad old days, everybody had to learn Afrikaans during apartheid, because the government felt that we should all have to speak it. The less said about that, the better, probably. So I learned Afrikaans because we had to, and then I chose to do Zulu. I constantly say that I believe that to have been the cleverest decision I ever made. It really has taken down a number of initial barriers that would have been there had I not been able to. I don't speak it like a Zulu, I still speak it like a white guy trying to speak Zulu, but people do appreciate the effort that is made. And then another question about my education and where did I get the knowledge to give some of the information that I do. And that's from Debbie in Torrance, California. Debbie, I did do a degree in biology, but when I finished my biology degree, I couldn't have identified, I mean this seriously, I could not have identified one tree out here. All of the knowledge that I have, the specific knowledge that I have from this area, is purely from working out here. And from a general interest in biology that's developed over the years, and I've just, you know, carried on my reading. For me, yes, the specifics are interesting. I do like to know what tree that is, what bird that is, what flower that is. But to me, the intermingling of the systems and how evolution has designed the systems around here, and how so like the woodpecker's brain you mentioned, I spoke earlier about the woodpecker's brain and how it's encased in some sponge to stop it getting concussion. That sort of stuff I find absolutely fascinating. And I've spoken a lot about the subject of infanticide, that sort of thing, and how the mammals, all the mammals seem to be connected in that way, I find absolutely fascinating. And that just comes from a personal interest and from reading. I have done it. I did another degree in human development, and certainly that helped to extend my language knowledge. And working out here has taught me to speak some Shangaan. Again, to a non-Shangaan speaker, I sound like I'm completely fluent, but to a Shangaan speaker, I do definitely still sound like a foreigner, if you like. So those lions are apparently around here. I'm just going to get a quick update from Scott, just to find out if he has had any luck. Scott Disson, do you copy? Scott, we have seen two mammals today. Have you had any luck with those tracks? I did. I was just so far from there that I haven't been there yet, and I thought I'd come into this area. I'm now on Albury's. Did you follow the tracks in at all anywhere? in the area. The tracks of the pride were around this area, so we'll just keep driving around here and see what we don't see if what we can pick up. Let's have a look at that hornbill, which might do its little display, although with our luck it will probably disappear at a great speed as soon as we put the camera on it. Yellow-billed hornbill, favorite bird of cameraman Andrew, who is currently celebrating with Brent in Hoedspruit. Look at the little display. That's a very half-hearted display. That's a sort of territorial display. So he's sitting very obviously on the top of a tree where he can be seen, and he'll make it, that call, and then often open the wings out. Just not today, of course. Let's carry on, Brian. There we go. Hooray! The territorial display from the yellow-billed hornbill. It is still a beautiful morning, despite the, I suppose the lack of action would be the best way of describing it. Certainly been plenty of action on this road recently, lots of zebra tracks. Brian, be sure to let me know if you see a lion, will you? Thanks. Carol, you want to know if we get wood storks here? Carol, I don't know what a wood stork is, so I'm going to assume, unless I have my head under a rock, we don't get them here. Here are the lion tracks. No? Hyena. Plenty of hyenas here. So Scott is on some lion tracks, and I think he's going to show them to you briefly. I'm just listening on the radio to some talk, some chatter about where the tracks might be. Now, this is can be a little bit of a dodgy signal area, so if we do start to break up signal, I'm sorry about that if that does happen. I'm going to stop here and listen for a little while. Brian, look at the rubbing post here. So this tree here, things are getting desperate when you're showing this sort of thing, is I'm not sure I can bring myself to talk about it.
There's a whole lot of mud on this tree, and that, at the height that it is probably from an elephant that has... Oh, shall I show you? Okay, let me go and show you. Good point, Brian. Nice directing there. This tree is where an elephant has thrown mud upon itself, come along here, and rubbed itself vigorously like so, and often like so, in order to get rid of parasites. And sometimes you can see the parasites caught in the mud. On a day like this, of course, there is nothing to be seen except the mud on the tree. And in order to really entertain you, I'll show you a close-up of the mud that was on the tree. There we go. Isn't that fascinating?
Beautiful.
Thank you. Now, of course, there are many animals that will do that. Buffalo are the obvious ones, and rhino also. They will like to do that, but that's at the height of an elephant, roughly. Right, after that entertaining cameo, we'll carry on. Right, we're mostly going to go across to Scott so you can have a break from staring at me. I'm here with some lion tracks with that special little camera, so I think you've got a nice angle and I'll just now.
Everyone, and welcome back. I am very close to the vehicle, so you don't have to be alarmed for my safety. And I've just hopped off because I'd like to show you some lion tracks. The road behind me over here is called Vuyatela Access. It's the main access road from outside of the reserve into the camps here at Juma. And this is where the Inkahuma Pride were moving last night. So what we're going to do is I'm just going to slowly show you where at least one of the lioness was walking. And as I point the downwards now, you will notice clearly you can see the tracks of where she walked. And interestingly, this was just one of the men from the pride that has walked down here. And there's no evidence of where the rest of pride is yet. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to turn around and we head back up this way and try and work out where the rest of the pride has gone. What may have been happening is that they may have been hunting and one of the lions may have looped around to try and encompass their prey. Another thing that has happened is that the people are tracking here, it's been Nicky and myself, as well as Lex and his guests, have circled the block several times and not found any of their tracks disappearing or moving out of this area. So we are quite confident that they could well have a kill somewhere in this bush. It is quite thick though, difficult to get a vehicle in there, but at least we are confident that there could well be a successful lion kill with the Inkahuma pride. So take a closer look now. I found the other track. Here we go. So you can see some tracks over here. And this is where the rest of the pride has moved. Easy to work out which one is which and what exactly they were doing here. I can't see any more tracks now, but I do know that already this morning quite a few vehicles would have driven up and down. Oh, here's some more here. Here we go. So this is where the majority of the pride was moving, and they're moving in a kind of north an easterly direction. Well, at least we've given you a bit of a taster as to what it is like when tracking animals and what to look for, but it's not an easy business. And I guess a big problem is that we're trying to work out how to get this backpack up and running properly so that we can incorporate you guys in the tracking and finding of the animals. It's really a wonderful, wonderful experience. It's very exciting. It's an absolute thrill when you do finally find the animals you're looking for. Even though it's often just a fleeting glimpse, you can never get nearly as close to the animals when on foot as compared to when you're on the vehicle. Unless they are flies, of course, of which I could feel two, one on each barrel of my nostrils. And I'm just gonna turn the camera around so you can see the vehicle. I haven't moved at all far away from the vehicle. Nicki's hiding there, but she's got a big smile on her face. But we're not gonna make it feel too awkward. But she's been also out with helping this morning. She has been doing a lot of the film work, but for this specific sequence, we thought we'd try something different. And hope you've enjoyed it. Shem, I really do feel sorry for James. He's had a tough morning. And all out alone with very, very little animals to see is not really the way you want to be out there for so many hours. But he is an entertainer. And I'm sure the fact that you guys haven't seen many animals has caused him to joke around. And I am told that the last thing he was doing was pretending he was an elephant with an itchy bottom. So that's something that I would like to watch as well. And thankfully, there should be some highlights of that that I can get to see as well. Anyway, we are going to keep working this area in the hope that we do find the Nkuhuma pride. Maybe, just maybe, we'll get to find them before the end of the show. Failing that, we will certainly be out searching this afternoon. And we are very, very hopeful that we will have the second vehicle up and running. But while it has been broken, it's been a great opportunity to test this backpack. As you can see, it's got equipment on it, and we nearly lost the camera there, but welcome back. And we're going to send you back to James shortly and try and carry on looking for these lion. I hope you've enjoyed, and we will see you all a little bit later.
Hello everybody, welcome back to Wendy, where we bring you the news that we have continued to find a greater abundance of Combritum apiculatum, Terminalia sericea, Ziziphus mucronata, and Phalaenoptera violacea. Those of course are all trees, they are leafless and therefore not particularly interesting at this time of the year. I believe, however, that Scott managed to show you some very nice tracks. Isn't that little camera, while you're on foot, it's a really nice little angle that we managed to get with it. And especially when operated by somebody with some camera competence like Scott. So, we have come around the block, and Scotty, I think, is probably going to walk in here and see what he can find. I'm pretty sure that his postulation that the lions have a kill in here is a good one. So, yeah, I'm not sure where they are going to be. I've got visual of Scott in front of me, but I didn't, you know what, I didn't see the lions crossing that track, I didn't see them crossing that road there. I think they're in here. I'm just going to go past Scott quickly and get an update from him. Scott is, of course, with Nicki in more ways than one. Hello. Hello! What a lovely morning. Certainly atmospherically anyway. How are you?
Good, thanks, James. Good. Hello, Brian.
Hello. Do you think we've gone in here?
I think they have.
They don't cross all these.
They don't. Neither Galago shortcuts.
There's one, you know what? We found there were four tracks on Galago, Galago shortcut this morning.
Okay.
They seemed to come out of the block and disappear back in, so I ignored them because they were on the
on the leopard tracks.
Okay.
So maybe they're closer to that side.
Okay. Nicki says she has just smelt death, which means that possibly...
Nicki smelt death, everyone.
So... There is a chance that they may have made a kill. I have seen lots of zebra tracks running around.
Yes.
Distressed zebra. So I think it might be worth us spending a little bit more time snooping around here.
I'm going to do Gallagher again then.
Cool.
Okay.
Sounds good.
You're going to head in here.
Yeah, I'm going to keep in this area and get Nicki on the scent trail.
Okay, good. Nicki, you keep that going then. Right, okay.
Cheers, everyone.
As you were. See you just now.
Cheers. Cheers, bebop.
You're a star now, Nick.
Bye-bye.
More tracks going down the road here. Well, at least the humans are entertaining at Juma, if nothing else. Genevieve in New York, you want to know what my opinion was of Scott's bucket playing last night. Now, for those of you who don't know, we had a fireside chat last night, and Scott was playing the bucket. Not figuratively, he was genuinely playing a bucket. And Genevieve, you want to know what my opinion was. Well, I don't think he's going to be called up to play Sting, for example, anytime soon. I think he's got a little bit of a way to go before then. I'd say that his sense of rhythm, by his own admission, is not perhaps as strong as the great drummers of the world. So, I mean, if we think of Charlie Watts of the Rolling Stones, or Carter Beaufort of the Dave Matthews Band, or Vinnie Colaiuta, who plays for Sting, I think that we're probably a level off that, shall we say, and that he's... look, he's got some work to do. Let's put it at that. Brian, what do you think?
Yeah,
a little bit of work, yeah. Yeah, quite a lot of work. Quite a lot of work. But it was very nice to have him on drums rather than sitting there. Because he said to me, look, could I not do something while you're playing the guitar? Because he says it feels a bit spare to just sit there. And so I said, well, why don't you play a bucket? So he said, I'd happily play a bucket. So that's what he did. We have just 15 minutes left of this drive. I'm truly hoping we're going to find something in the way of a lion by then. But the universe has not exactly smiled upon us today in terms of mammals. Now, another personal question from Dr. Debbie, and a nice one. If I could change into any animal, what would I change into so that I could, in order to better understand their society? Gee whiz. You know, the thing that I would probably try and be, I would probably like to be an elephant. I would probably really like to understand more about elephant communication and how they talk to each other and the extent to which they are able to talk to each other. So, Dr. Debbie, I reckon I'd go with elephant. Where would you go, Brian? Really? Elephant. Leopards also, to some extent. Apparently, big cat trainers will tell you that, or some will tell you that they're as intelligent as dolphins. I'm not really sure if that's true or not. I don't think I'd want to be a lion. Lions have a fairly vicious society. I'd like to be a wild dog, actually. Probably a wild dog or an elephant, Dr. Debbie. So the lions, we think, are in here. That's where Nicki smelt death earlier on. There's a vulture, Brian. There's a vulture flying over this block. Let's watch it carefully. Go ahead. Look at that. Wouldn't it be wonderful if it just plummeted to the ground? We're just going to watch this vulture carefully. So while we're watching it, hoping that it's going to fold its wings and dive for the floor, Samantha, you'd like to know if I've had any scary moments on Juma or Arethusa. Samantha, I've had one, and that was when the orange-eyed Nguhuma lioness walked up to the car, just like normal, like they often do, and instead of just moving on, she actually looked me in the eyes, and I did really get a fright from that. I'm not sure why. Well, not a fright so much as an awakening. It was actually quite a nice feeling. And that vulture is looking at something. I'm going to keep watching it. So, Samantha, that was probably the scariest moment I've had here on Juma and Arethusa.
Not the catfish?
Not the catfish, no. No, Brian, that was just the most unmanly sound that I made. And it wasn't actually that scary. I'm just going to quickly tell Scott to watch the vulture. Scott, come in. Scott, there is a lone vulture doing figure of eights over this block. I don't know if you can see it. If it was genuinely spotted something, it would actually come down. I think we'll just keep an eye, but we're going to carry on going forward for the next little while. It's starting to get quite warm now, and so the vultures will start to fly. So it's difficult. Sometimes you see huge numbers of them and you think, well, there must be something dead or dying around there. Death has occurred, but often when as it starts to get warm, so the vultures will start to fly because the thermals start to rise with the earth. And just to keep you posted, the Birmingham males have been found. Naturally, nowhere anywhere near Juma. They are on Biffle's Hook, and so they've travelled a huge distance. Look, there are whole lots of vultures now going up, so I think it's just a function, possibly, of the thermals. Very slowly along here. Still watching that one behind us. Slightly convinced that it knows something that we don't. But I think it's getting higher and higher at this stage. Nice question, of course, is how on earth did the Birmingham boys, which don't come from Birmingham in England, how did they get their name, the Birmingham boys? And that's from Angie in Portland. Angie, they come from a farm called Birmingham, and the farm called Birmingham is in the south of the Timbavati. So if you think of the western extremities of the Kruger National Park, you've got the Sabi Sands, Then you've got the Manuleti, and then north of that, the Timbavati. And the farm Birmingham is in the southern end of the Timbavati, and I think that these lions come from there. And their name, it's not like the leopards where there's sort of a privileged, the first person to find them gets to name them. They just kind of assume a name after a while. What do you got there, Brian? Nothing. So Lex is also around here trying to find these lions. Trying to find where I found those tracks. Brian, just have a look down there. Hyenas going the other way. So I think we're too far north now. Anyway, Scott is the other side. He's going to keep going in there for a while. But I suspect we might have to find them between drives and come back this afternoon. Yeah, there are lots of hyena tracks going up and down the road, but of course the road is also the same road on which the hyena den is. We're driving along in a seemingly pointless fashion, hoping desperately that we might get sign of these lions. They're, you know, they're just not designed for it. Evolution has designed them to fill a niche that is more suited to them being in a pride than being on their own. And certainly the monogamous nature of them does, or the kind of sexual system that they have doesn't really come into it. It's the most stable that it can be, and it's the best strategy that there is for the perpetuation of genes under the sort of pride system. So, yeah, it's a difficult one to answer, not very easy, and it's a complex answer to give. There's a bataleur. Now, the bataleur you need to watch, because they do attract vultures. But what's interesting here is this bataleur is being attacked. See that? Brian, there's something above it, right into the sun. It looks like a little sparrowhawk or a goshawk. I'm just going to quickly get hold of Lex. Lex, come in. Because I can hear him in the block here. Lex, are you off-road there? Okay, copy. Scott, is that you off the road between Gallagher and Aubrey's? Okay, copy, thanks. I think I'm just quite close to Aubrey's. No, negative, Lex. I'm standing by there just looking at a bataleur, hoping desperately for a dive at a kill, but I don't think that that's happening. So, it has been quite a morning of, quite a morning of driving, really. Lex and Scott are in the block here looking for the lions. I suspect that they are going to find those lions basically as we go off air, which will be entirely consistent with our general luck for the morning. Anyway, I've had an interesting time. We have seen lots of trees. We've seen some very nice bird life, actually. And I thank you profusely for constantly asking questions and sending through comments, because I have to tell you, taking an entertaining game drive without those comments and questions in the absence of any kind of mammal life would have presented something of a trial. But it's actually been quite an interesting day while we've been out here. Hopefully by the afternoon jigger will be fixed. I have a nasty suspicion that it won't be, in which case you'll have Scott for 3 hours and I will do what he was doing today and just try and find some interesting angles with that great little camera. And so that's the plan for the afternoon. I must just say a big thank you to Brian, who is going to show you something very special. In fact, he's probably going to show you the most interesting thing that we've had all morning. Brian, how close are we? There we go. Look at that. There we go. The thumb has made a xylene-infused appearance because of the...
Xylene-free pens.
Xylene-free pens. Well done, Brian. So thank you, Brian, for your patience and all the effort that you've made. A big thank you to Tara for feeding through the questions, of course, and to Kirsty, who's been helping her with that in the final control. Eugene, as I say often, is knocking about the place. He was injured quite badly by a strychnos tree the other day. The strychnos got 1 point and he got zero, but he seems to be on the up and fixing all of the difficult things that he has to do during the day. So thank you once again for all of your efforts. It's been a wonderful morning. A thank you to Scott and Nicki, of course, for all of their efforts in the bush. They're still on foot now trying to find those lions. I suspect in the next 20 seconds they'll probably find them, by which time you will be looking at a highlights reel. I'm not sure you can describe it as a highlights reel. But anyway, we will see you this afternoon. Thank you once again. It's been a really lovely morning, and we'll see you this afternoon. Bye-bye.